Do you think at this point the amount of power that the president has is corrupting to the to their ability to lead well? Is this is you know power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Mm-hmm. Are we is there too much power in the presidency?
There definitely is. And part of the problem, and one of the things I try to make come across to people is if you're the president, unless you have a hyper-intentional view of how something must be different in government, your view doesn't matter. So for example, like if you were Trump, let's take Trump even, and even in with a pretty intentional view, he was like, I'm going to end the war in Afghanistan and Iraq, right? And he came in and he gets these generals in. He's like, I want to end the war in Afghanistan and Iraq. Oh, and I want to withdraw these troops from Syria. Mm-hmm. And they're like, okay, we'll give us like 6 months. He's like, okay. And this is the thing about Trump. He doesn't realize that it's bullshit. Yeah. So they're like, he's like, yeah, 6 months seems fine, right? So then 6 months comes and he's like, so, and then he'll announce it. He'll be like, and we're getting out of Syria. It's great. And then the generals freak out. They're like, whoa, whoa, whoa. We don't have a plan for that. He's like, but you guys told me 6 months. He's like, I don't know. Now we need another 6 months in order to figure this thing out.
Yeah.
So that's how, and by that time, now you're midterms. So now what? Yeah. Now you got to run for re-election. So more what I mean by that is, if you don't have a hyper-intentional view about how to change foreign policy, if you don't have a hyper-intentional view about how the Department of Commerce should do its job, they are just going to go on autopilot. So this is part of the problem. When you ask me about the presidency, it's not the presidency itself, like the president himself, which has become too powerful. It's that we have less democratic checks on the people and the systems that are on autopilot. And I would say that basically since 2008, we have voted every single time to disrupt that system, except in the case of 2020 with Joe Biden, and there are a lot of different reasons around why that happened. Mm-hmm. And in every single one of those cases, Obama and Trump, they all failed in order to radically disrupt that. And that just shows you how titanic the task is. And I'm using my language precisely because I don't want to be like deep state and all, but like obviously there's deep state.
Deep state, I guess, has conspiratorial tinges to it. But so what you're saying is the true power currently lies with the autopilot,
yeah.
AKA deep state.
Well, but see, it's not, this is the thing too I want to make in clear, because I think people think conspiratorially that they're all coming together to intentionally do something. No. They are doing what they know, believe they are right, and don't have real democratic checks within that. And so now they have entire generations of cultures within each of these bureaucracies where they say, this is the way that we do things around here.
Yeah.
And that's the problem, which is that we have a culture of within many of these agencies and more. I think the best example for this would be during the Ukraine, you know, gate with Trump and all that, with the impeachment. And I'm not talking about the politics here, but the most revealing thing that happened was when the whistleblower guy, Alexander Vindman, was like, here you have the president departing from the policy of the United States. And I was like, well, let me educate you, Lieutenant Colonel. The president of the United States makes American foreign policy.
Yeah.
But it was a very revealing comment because he and met all the people within national security bureaucracy do think that. They're like, this is the policy of the United States. It's we have to do this. That's where things get screwy.
Well, listen, for me personally, but also from an engineering perspective, I just talked to Jim Keller. It's just, this is the kind of bullshit that we all hate in when you're trying to innovate and design new like products.
Right.
So like that's what first principles thinking requires, is like, we don't give a shit what was done before. The point is, what is the best way to do it? And it seems like the current government in general, probably bureaucracies in general, are just really good at being lazy about never having those conversations. Mm-hmm. And just, it becomes this momentum thing that nobody has the difficult conversations. It's become a game within a certain set of constraints, and they never kind of do revolutionary tasks. But you did say that the presidency is power, mm-hmm. but you're saying that more power than the others, but that power has to be coupled with like focused intentionality. Like you have to keep hammering the thing.
If you want it done, it has to be done. I mean, and you gotta, and this is the other part too, which is that it's not just that you have to get it done, you have to pick the 100 people who you can trust to pick 10 people each to actually do what you want. One of the most revealing quotes is from a guy named Tommy Corcoran. He was the top aide to FDR. This I'm getting from the Kara books too. And he said, what is a government? It's not just one guy or even 10 guys. Hell, it's 1,000 guys.
Yeah.
And what FDR did is he masterfully picked the right people to execute his will through the federal agencies. Johnson was the same way. He played these people like a fiddle. He knew exactly who to pick. He knew the system and more. Part of the reason that outsiders who don't have a lot of experience in Washington almost always fail is they don't know who to pick. Or they pick people who say one thing to their face, and then when it comes time to carry out the president's policy in terms of the government, they just don't do it. And the president's too, think about this. I think Rahm Emanuel said this. He was like, by the time it gets to the president's desk, nobody else can solve it. It's not easy. It's not like a yes or a no question. It's every single thing that hits the president's desk is incredibly hard to do. And Obama actually even said, and this was a very revealing quote about how he thinks about the presidency, which is, he's like, look, the presidency is like one of those super tankers. You know, he's like, I can come in and I can make it 2 degrees left and 2 degrees right. In 100 years, 2 degrees left, that's a whole different trajectory.
Yeah.
Same thing on the right. And he's like, that ultimately is really all you can do. I quibble and disagree with that in terms of how he could have changed things in 2008, but there's a lot of truth to that statement.
Okay, that's really fascinating. You make me realize that actually both Obama and Trump are probably playing victim here to the system. You're making me think that maybe you can correct me that, because I'm thinking of like Elon Musk, whose major success despite everything is hiring the right people.
Exactly.
And like creating those thousands, that structure of 1,000 people. So maybe a president has power in that if they were exceptionally good at hiring the right people.
Personnel is policy, man. That's what it comes down to.
But wouldn't you be able to steer the ship way more than 2 degrees if you hire the right people? So like, it's almost like Obama was not good at hiring the right people.
Well, he hired all the Clinton people. Yeah. That's what happened. What happened with Trump? He hired all the Bush people.
And then you just sit back and say, oh, president can't, but that means you're just suck at hiring.
Correct. Yeah. I mean, look, I know it's funny. I'm giving you simultaneously the nationalist case against Trump and the progressive case against Obama.
Yes.
The progressive people were like, why the fuck are you hiring all these Clinton people in order to run the government and just recreate? Like, why are you hiring Larry Summers, who was one of the people who worked at all these banks and didn't believe the bailouts were going to be big enough, and then to come in the worst economic crisis in modern American history? Yeah. That was 2008. And Summers actively lobbied against larger bailouts, which had huge implications for working class people and pretty much hollowed out America since. Okay, from Trump, same thing. You're like, I'm going to drain the swamp. And by doing that, I'm going to hire Goldman Sachs's Gary Cohn and Steve Mnuchin and all these other absolute Bush clowns in order to run my White House. Well, yeah, no shit. The only thing that you accomplished in your 4 years in office is passing a massive tax cut for the rich and for corporations. I wonder how that happened.